Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Now, this is the second part of our discussion anti-malarial. In the first part, we have already discussed the different stages of malarial parasite and then the drugs acting on these different stages. And at the same time, in the last few slides, we started our discussion regarding the drugs used in different clinical settings. Are different clinical condition. So in this part we will further see some more drugs or recommendation, especially by the WHO as far as the anti-malarial concerned in different setting, and also we will start discussing the important aspects of different anti-malarial drugs. Now regarding the WHO recommendation, especially for the treatment of Plasmodium falciparum infection, because that is the main lethal type of infection. Now the first regimen is artemether with lumefantrine. This combination is actually recommended as a first line therapy in many countries suffering from falciparum malarial infection, and even it is approved in the USA. Second combination is artesunate with the amodioquine. This is again very useful in the falciparum infection, especially in many African countries. Third combination is artesunate with mefloquine. This is especially useful as a first line therapy in parts of Southeast Asia and South America. And the fourth combination is dihydroartemisinin with piperaquine. This is especially first line therapy in the treatment of falciparum malarial infection in some countries other than the third part of the Southeast Asian countries. And the fifth combination is artesunate with the sulfadoxine and pyrimethamine. These three drugs are combined to use as a first line therapy in some countries, but efficacy of this combination is lower than other in most of the those areas in which other combination are useful. Now drugs for the prevention of malaria in travelers. For example, in those areas in which Plasmodium falciparum is still sensitive to chloroquine, for prevention also we will use chloroquine in a dose of 500 milligram per week weekly. We will repeat it after 7 days. Then those areas in which chloroquine resistance Plasmodium falciparum infection is present. Here, obviously, we cannot use chloroquine, but we use a combination of atovaquine with the proguanil under the name of melaranon in the ratio of 250 milligram and 100 milligram respectively. Or we can use mefloquine 250 milligram weekly. There are some other areas also, but not only against chloroquine, but resistant developed to so many other drugs also. So multi-drug resistant area with the Plasmodium falciparum. Here we usually use one of the most important tetracycline, long acting tetracycline, that is doxycycline 100 milligram daily. Now all these drugs are used as per schedule until the person is residing in that prevailing area in which infection malaria is very common. It will be started before entering into that area and it will be continued till the total stay of that person in that area. Then terminal prophylaxis of Plasmodium vivax and ovale infection. Here actually because Plasmodium vivax we have seen, because relapses are occurring, similarly with the ovale also, because here secondary schizones are present in the liver. So we have to address that also. If we have address prophylactically till the person is residing. But if the secretory isotopes are present in the liver, even then, if that patient has left that area, he may again start suffering from the attacks of acute malaria. So in this case, obviously, tissue anti-malarial drug pramequine in the same dose, very specific 52.6 milligram, which contain actually 30 milligram of pramequine in the form of base. It is also given daily for 14 days even after the travel, even after the person has left the area. This must be remembered, it's very important. For primary prevention, for the first time, obviously 30 milligram base, the same dose is daily till the person is residing in that area. And prophylaxis in pregnancy, in all types of weather, falciparum, vivax, ovale, malaria, etc., usually we give chloroquine or mefloquine in the respective dosage, 500 milligram per week. So these all are short essay questions and the Viva questions and MC questions also. So you must remember all these clinical conditions in which these particular drugs are useful. During the first lecture, first part, we were discussing the treatment. Here we are discussing the prevention. Now, the first important drug which we will discuss, that is chloroquine. Chemically, it is a 4-aminocholinine derivatives. It is a weak base, alkaline in nature, which is highly specific for the asexual form of the Plasmodia, while the parasites are present in the human being. Now, we should again recall our this fact to understand the mechanism of action of chloroquine, that is, malarial parasites are killed by the toxic effects of heme, which the malarial parasites were producing themselves when they were digesting the hemoglobin. Toxic amounts of hemes are present, are released or synthesized, which can kill malarial parasites themselves. So the oxidative effects of excessive free radicals occur. Now, mechanism of action of chloroquine. Remember, when the malarial parasites enter into the RBCs, they digest the oxygen-carrying pigment hemoglobin because they are in search of the amino acid present in the hemoglobin. So they divide the hemoglobin into two parts, heme and the globin. As we have seen, the heme is toxic to the malarial parasite itself also. So to prevent itself, this parasite polymerizes this heme into non-toxic pigment hemozoin. Now this hemozoin inhibits the peroxidative activity of the heme, toxic activity of the heme. Now chloroquine, actually, I have told you again diagrammatically in the last fourth part, chloroquine prevents the polymerization of this heme into hemozoin. So the accumulation of heme occur, that will result in the death or the lytic effect of both the parasites and obviously of the RBCs also. So no doubt there will be hemolysis also, but at the same time chloroquine will kill malarial parasites also due to increased accumulation of the heme. This one, okay. So lytic effect of parasites and RBCs are seen. Now, what will be the mechanism of action of chloroquine? So obviously, by considering the previous discussion, remember, first of all, chloroquine itself is concentrated in the acidic food vacuole of RBCs, primarily by ion trapping, because it is basic in nature. So in the opposite medium it become ionized. So in the form of ion trapping, it get concentrated in the acidic food vacuole of the RBCs. So in the food vacuole, the parasite digests the hemoglobin to obtain the essential amino acids present in that. And during this process, obviously, I have seen large amounts of heme is released and which is toxic to the parasite. So the increased accumulation of heme will result in oxidative damage to the membranes of the parasite, leading to its lytic effect. So not only the parasite, as we have seen, of the RBCs also. So again, we recall that to protect itself, the parasite polymerizes the heme to a pigment non-toxic, which is liquid in the parasite vacuole. So chloroquine actually specifically binds to the heme and thus prevents the polymerization of the heme into hemozyme. Remember, this is the important step of anti-plasmodial activity of chloroquine. So this is the main key point in the mechanism action of chloroquine. Regarding the pharmacokinetic, it is rapidly absorbed and given orally. However, we can give through intramuscular and subcutaneous route also. But if we give intravenously, we have seen that even single injection of chloroquine given intravenously may produce lethal effects, because lethal concentrations starts present in the circulation. Regarding plasma protein binding, it's 60% of chloroquine and distribution is relatively slower than the absorption. However, volume distribution is very, very large. That is 13,000 liter. We have already discussed this point in the general pharmacology. But now again, you should remember the volume distribution of chloroquine is 13,000 liter. This is actually due to extensive sequestration of chloroquine in the variety of the body tissue, including liver, spleen, kidney, lungs, and even this melanin containing tissue, obviously skin, etc., and the retina. So even in the brain and the spinal cord, although less, but they are present in those areas also. We have seen that the two active metabolites are also synthesized, that is diacetylchloroquine and bidiacetylchloroquine. They may lead to produce toxic effects in the various body tissues also. Now this chloroquine along with these toxic metabolites are excreted through kidney. Half-life is about 3 to 5 days, but terminal half-life is up to 60 days. But what we have seen interestingly, that traces of chloroquine can be found in the urine coming out even after years of the therapeutic doses, years after we have stopped, but even traces of chloroquine can be detected in the urine of those patients. This is very important aspect, must be remembered. It may be again a Viva question, or SCQ, or MCQ. Regarding pharmacological effects, now pharmacological effects are actually according to the resistance developed against chloroquine. Remember, if resistance not developed, chloroquine is highly effective for the blood schizontricidal effects against sensitive plasmodium falciparum especially. It is also moderately effective against gametocyte of plasmodium vivax of ALL miliary, but remember this point, not against gametocytes of the plasmodium falciparum. Again, this point is important regarding Viva, OSPI and MCQ. Another important point is chloroquine is not active against hepatic stage of parasite, so it is not useful to eradicate Plasmodium vivax and a whale infection in which secondary chiasmons are present. Which drug was used in those conditions? Yes, paramyquine. Now let's see therapeutic indication. Now first of all, anti-malarial uses. As we have seen, if sensitive, then chloroquine is highly effective against acute attacks of erythrocytic form of all types of vivax, whale, malaria, and chloroquine sensitive strains of Plasmodium falciparum. What we have seen, when given a triple terminates the especially fever within 1 to 2 days, and regarding the parasitemia, parasite present in the blood, they are cleared within 3 days, 48 to 72 hours. And again, remember, if the malaria parasite sensitive, otherwise the parasite will not be cleared. They will continue present in the blood. However, nowadays chloroquine has been replaced by other drugs like artemisinin based combination as a standard therapy to treat falciparum malaria in most endemic countries. It is artemisinin based combinations. This is again Viva and Oswee question. Chloroquine is preferred chemophylactic agent also in malarious regions in the non-resistant falciparum malaria. And also it is effective against gametocytes of vivax, whale and malaria, as we have seen in the previous slides. So may be useful against their spread of malaria, but again not effective against those of Plasmodium falciparum. It's just the repetition of the previous slides to stress the point. And fourth one is for the radical cure, complete cure form of the vivax and of whale with paramyquine. So if we use paramyquine with chloroquine, a radical cure, complete cure of Plasmodium vivax and of whale will occur. Now the non-malarial uses, other uses. And there's a long list is there. We have seen their role, especially in the hepatic amoebic abscess, especially when the initial metronidazole therapy fails, then we may start chloroquine in this condition. Chloroquine has also been useful in rheumatoid arthritis, systemic lupus erythematosus, discoid lupus, sarcoidosis, or even photosensitive disease like ulcerated skin blisters and severe polymorphous light eruption. And currently, some potential benefits have been seen in the infection of COVID-19, but it's also potential to produce dysrhythmias is also very serious consideration. Adverse effects with anti-malarial doses, chloroquine have been seen very safe. At least what we have seen, only minor type of which in which pruritus is common, but some patient may also complain of nausea, vomiting, abdominal pain, headache, anorexia, malaise, blurring of vision, etc., etc. But even these symptoms are reduced when given after meal. When the dosages are used for prolonged period or in high amount, for example, in disease-modifying anti-rheumatic drugs or in autoimmune diseases, they can cause irreversible retinopathy, what we call as bull's eye in melanin-rich retina. Along with that, there may be ototoxicity, myopathy, confusion, or even convulsions we have seen. And some patients may go into coma and peripheral neuropathy. Rarely, some neuropsychiatric problem like suicidal attempts have been also observed. And if the toxic doses or toxic amounts are achieved very acutely or after intramuscular injection or after IV infusion, these can result in respiratory depression and even severe hypotension. And we have seen depressed myocardial functions also, and arrhythmias and cardiac arrest. So remember, we must be very careful in raising the toxic concentration of these drugs, especially in acute stage. Resistance to antimicrobial effect of chloroquine is also very common, which we have discussed previously, especially against plasmodium falciparum. This is actually due to decreased intracellular accumulation, and this occurs especially due to increased efflux of the chloroquine by the membrane pumps present in the bilary parasite. And it is not only against chloroquine, it is against other anti-malarial drugs also. Second, we have seen multi-drug resistant acid transporter. Here, resistance developed against the transporter, and it develops due to mutation in the polymorphic gene, and then this transporter also showing resistance to these anti-malarial drugs. Because it's calcium channel operated pump or transporter, okay, we have seen chloroquine resistance is reversed by the especially verapamil, or it can be reversed by desipramine and chlorpheniramine also. Now another thing is that gradually we are observing the resistance is developed against some strains of plasmodium vivax. So not only plasmodium falciparum, but the new condition is that we are observing resistance against plasmodium vivax also. Contraindications. Because we have seen previously a variety of adverse effects, especially convulsions, etc., and other cardiovascular and CNS effects, so and peripheral nervous system. So contraindication: epilepsy, myopathy and myasthenia gravis, psoriasis, skin conditions, retinal or visual field abnormalities, because it gets accumulated into the retina, we have seen. Then curing, calcium and magnesium containing acids, they will reduce the absorption of chloroquine. Increased plasma level and toxicity of mefloquine, digoxin, anticonvulsant, cyclosporin, all will lead to increase the toxic effects of chloroquine. Then problem in the liver, neurological or hematological disorders. Chloroquine is safe in pregnancy and for young children. So this pregnancy is not contraindicated for chloroquine. Now the quinine and quinidine, both these drugs are derived from the cinchona bark, and again they are alkaline in nature. They are cinchona bark alkaloids. Quinine, it is more potent antimalarial, but at the same time more toxic also with the shorter half-life. So therefore nowadays we are preferring quinidine for both as antimalarial, and we have already discussed its role in as antimalarial. As far as the pharmacokinetic is concerned, quinine is readily absorbed when given orally or even intramuscularly. Oral absorption that occurs mainly from the upper part of the small intestine, and almost 80% of the absorption is complete there. And even this absorption is not affected during diarrhea. Otherwise, diarrhea can affect absorption of majority of the drugs. Peak plasma levels, they are achieved within 3 hours. And these levels are high in severe malarial infection, but at the same time, they increase plasma protein binding also, so that prevent the toxicity of quinine. Due to increased plasma protein binding, less free form of quinine. Half-life may increase up to 18 hours. The concentration of quinine in various body tissues is lower than the plasma, and except fetal tissue, where quinine will be present in much, much higher concentration. only 20% of the quinine is excreted in the urine as unchanged form. Then there is active metabolite, 3-hydroxyquinone. This can be accumulated and possibly can cause toxic effects also, especially in the renal failure. When increased amounts of quinine and its active metabolite, hydroxyquinone occur. Regarding the active malarial effects and mechanism of action of quinine, that is probably similar to chloroquine, and also it acts similarly against the asexual erythrocyte form. Quinine is effective orally for uncomplicated and apparently for severe type of illness due to plasmodium falciparum and even against the resistant strains of plasmodium falciparum. Because it's very toxic than the quinidine and its half-life is shorter one, quinine is generally not useful for chemoprophylaxis aspect of the malaria. As we have seen, or we are saying repeatedly, quinine is more toxic and less effective than chloroquine and artemisinin against sensitive malarial parasites. Another important effects of quinine is on the skeletal muscle, because it decreases the excitability of the motor end plate and the response to not only repetitive nerve stimulation but also the response to acetylcholine. It also antagonizes the action of physostigmine on skeletal muscle, and at the same time it may also produce alarming respiratory distress and dysphagia, especially the patient suffering from myasthenia gravis. Now, resistance also develop against quinine, but here what we have seen, okay, this resistance develops in the same way as resistance develop against the chloroquine, or even in some cases more closely to mefloquine and halofenterine. And also we have seen a number of transporter genes that may confer resistance to quinine, as seen previously in case of chloroquine. Therapeutic uses of quinine and quinidine. Both are used in severe form of plasmodium falciparum. Here usually we give intravenously loading dose and it is life saving, and that is followed by the oral therapy for about a week. But we must remember that nowadays artemisinin therapy has become the number one choice in the plasmodium falciparum infection. As far as the multi-drug resistance strain is concerned against of plasmodium falciparum, in this such cases chloroquine is useful, but usually we enhance the efficacy of chloroquine by adding tetracycline or clindamycin along with this quinine. And third use is the nocturnal leg cramps at bedtime. Usually there are some patients who are feeling severe pain in their legs due to cramps, and they can be relieved by giving this quinine in the dose of 2-3 mg. But again, we must keep mind in these adverse effects of quinine while we are using quinine in these cases. Another condition is babesiosis. This is caused by a very tiny parasite, Babesia, which is spread by the ticks. So usually a life-threatening infection of RBCs in human being occurs in these cases, and symptoms usually resemble to malaria with obviously severe hemolysis in such cases and severe organ failure. So it must be treated with quinine immediately. In this first line therapy is quinine along with clindamycin. Now, toxicity and the side effects. The common toxic effects, that is mild synchronism. It may become severe also with increased doses. But even with the third doses, mild synchronism we have observed. And symptoms are usually tinnitus, high tone deafness, visual disturbances, headache, dysphoria, nausea, vomiting, and postural hypertension. And remember, all will disappear immediately after withdrawal of quinine and quinidine. The word synchronism means actually the toxic effects of the synchrona bark derivative, because this quinine and quinidine, etc., they are derived from the synchrona bark. So that is why the toxic effects are known as synchronism. Hypoglycemia is also very common and life-threatening, and usually it is due to hyperinsulinemia, increased release of insulin into the blood. And remember, it should be treated immediately with intravenous glucose. Then, although rare, but hypertension can also be seen, which is associated with excessively rapid IV infusion of quinine and quinidine. Though prolonged and high dose of this quinine up to 8 gram, that is fatal. Remember, this dose is fatal, must be kept in mind. And symptoms are usually related to GIT and skin, etc., and cardiovascular system, with the GIT, nausea, vomiting, abdominal pain, and diarrhea. And this is usually due to local irritation. But the nausea and vomiting may be due to stimulation of the vomiting center also. Some cutaneous manifestation have also been observed, like flushing, sweating, rash, angioedema, and all are especially on the face. Changes in the ECG, mild QTC prolongation, which is unaffected by the concurrent use of mefloquine. And the acute overdosage of quinidine especially, as we have seen, may be fatal. And we have seen sinus arrest, junctional arrhythmias, AV node block, and then the ventricular tachycardia and fibrillation. All are very common with the quinine and quinidine. Then very, very rare, that is hypersensitivity, mild hemolysis, and thrombocytopenia. Hypersensitivity are allergic reactions, especially involving the RBCs. Severe hemolysis may be there. And rarely, hemoglobinuria and asthma. And also, some rare allergic reaction is black water fever. This is again due to massive hemolysis and due to presence of hemoglobinemia and hemoglobinuria, that leading to may anuria also, and damage to kidney, renal failure, and even death can occur due to this black water fever. Mild hemolysis is especially seen in those patients who are suffering from glucose 6-phosphate dehydrogenase deficiency. And thrombocytopenic, also known as cocktail purpura, combination of different types of reaction. Hypoprothrombinemia, leukopenia, agranulocytosis also seen. Now, precautions are contraindication. First precaution is, or especially contraindication is, quinine hypersensitive patient, allergic to quinine, especially if hemolysis is seen in those patients. And number two, with precaution, we should use the patient suffering from tinnitus, optic neuritis, cardiac arrhythmias, etc. In pregnancy, it is safe, but because it can increase the release of insulin, so blood glucose level must be monitored during pregnancy if used using these quinine. Both the drugs are not given subcutaneously because they can irritate locally. Severe irritation occurs. And if concentrated solutions of these drugs are used, they may cause abscess at the site of intramuscular or even thrombophlebitis at the IV infusion sites. Now, regarding drug interactions, aluminum antacid can delay the absorption of quinine from the GIT. But at the same time, this quinine, quinidine, they can also delay the absorption of cardiac glycoside, warfarin, and the related anticoagulants. The action of quinine at the neuromuscular junction, we have seen they can enhance the effects of neuromuscular blocker. And they also oppose the action of acetylcholine esterase inhibitor. Two drugs, prochlorperazine and alfenterine, they can amplify the कार्डियोटॉक्सिक इफेक्ट्स ऑफ क्विनीन एंड वी हैव सीन के क्विनीन रेड क्लीयरेंस कैन बी डिक्रीज बाय सेमरेटिडिन एंड इंक्रीज बाय यूरिन एसिडिफिकेशन एंड बाय रिफैम्पिन.